Welcome to First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis, the birthplace of Congregational Humanism. We carry on that tradition of free thought today, dedicated to promoting a free search for truth, meaning, and justice. Our web address is firstunitarian.org. I'm David Breeden, Senior Minister. Welcome. Our annual auction is coming up Saturday, April the 22nd. The first order of business is getting donations. Go to the FUS website auction page and fill out your donation online. Then send the photos to auction@firstunitarian.org and we'll do the rest. What can you donate? We love experiences which will get us together. How about a dinner for six or a weekend at the cabin? Teach a class. Donate your handicrafts. Everyone loves homemade food, cakes, candy, jellies, and jams. Or donate your time and special skills in someone's house or garden. Or any electronic item, new or in good shape, will surely sell. Open the online page or see Barb Lutz downstairs after assembly today and get those donations rolling in. Okay, well, welcome everyone to First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis on a joyful occasion. We are going to celebrate spring, whether it's here or not. Yeah, it's not gonna bully us, no way. Joining me today, our music director, Mike Vosich, the seasonal celebrations team that you will see very soon, and our house band, the Eclectics. Yes, yes, kids, you too can dream of being an eclectic someday. It is part of our, you know, every good bar and every good congregation has one. So we have a house band, and you too can dream of being eclectic, because they definitely choose some eclectic music. Welcome, everyone, to this place of love and justice, where we attempt to live the highest of human ideals. Do we fail there? Oh, yep, we do, but we just keep on trying. A special meal today for our Equinox luncheon. We have a Stop and Top potato station featuring black bean chili, ham and cheese, or spicy mock duck toppings. Ham and cheese, and let's see. Yes, and a very eggy egg bake. You can get that gluten-free and vegetarian. And we've got sweet and savory pancake picks, crispy cornmeal flapjacks. How about that? And spicy kimchi hotcakes. Yes. And last but certainly not least, Perry's mimosas. Perry is a member of our seasonal celebrations team. If you've had our mimosas here, yes, it was a dark and stormy night the first time Perry ever mixed one of these, and he realized not only was it good, but it was perfect. So you too can experience that after our assembly today. At 4 p.m. today, join me at the Westminster Presbyterian congregation, where I will be joining in with other downtown clergy to discuss our recent civil rights pilgrimage, snacks and that kind of thing. And they have underground parking, which is, I really don't like it that they are able to brag about that, but they brag about it. They brag about it, and they do have it. So there you go. If everyone in the building here would look over your shoulder and wave at the little green dot up there, hey, everybody at home, and everybody at home, please wave back. And wherever you are, look to your right and your left, please, and say, "I'm happy you're here today." I'm happy you're here today. Absolutely. Yes, yes. First Unitarian Society is a member congregation of the Unitarian Universalist Associations of Congregations, and we are an intentionally and radically inclusive congregation who takes care of our folks and our city and the world beyond. Downstairs today, see what the Active Voices folks are up to. And if you're new, join in by talking at the welcome table and finding out all kinds of things. And we are so glad you are here today. Take it away. When we gather, we light our chalice in remembrance and celebration of one of our FUS aspirations, or one of our UU, Unitarian Universalist principles. Today, the seventh Unitarian Universalist principle, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. Thank you, Paul. Well, welcome everyone to our celebration of the vernal equinox. As is our custom here at First Unitarian Society, we celebrate the change of the seasons over the course of the year. This morning, we're staging our own spring pageant to bring in the colors, the sights, and the sounds of the season to tide us over until spring's natural splendor actually emerges here in Minnesota. The days are indeed lengthening. You have noticed that. Yay, the light is growing stronger, and before long, pastel colors like my shirt and new life will be on full display everywhere. We will take heed of the onset of spring to be reminded that out of old skins and spent forms, rejuvenation does happen. We pause to observe this renewal in the natural world, and we welcome the possibilities of renewal in our own lives to reinvigorate our weary bodies and dispirited minds through celebration together. We begin with calling the quarters, acknowledging the seasonal change we experience through the four elements, air, fire, water, and earth, the elements that our ancestors have honored for centuries. Each of these personified elements will come forward to extol the new season. Then the Eclectics will lead us in a musical response while the children process to the front with tokens of springtime. The words to the musical response for you all to turn the world around will appear on our screen. So now let's welcome the spring equinox, a time of celebration as the days lengthen, the earth awakens from winter's sleep, and the cycle of life begins again.
Greetings from air of the east and the first spring breezes, which carry the migrating butterflies home and scatter the seeds of flowers to come, filling the air with the scent of green buds and the sound of bird songs. Welcome, spring. Welcome, gentle beauty. Celebrate this season of new life and new possibilities.
From fire of the south and the sun's warm rays, which enliven buds and seeds, showing us the first sign of color in the corner of an eye, from a passing bird or a sprouting crocus, washing the world in golden light. Welcome, spring. Welcome, gentle beauty. Celebrate this season of new life and new possibilities.
We come from the fire, living in the fire. Go back to the fire, turn the world around. We come from the fire, living in the fire. Go back to the fire, turn the world around.
Greetings from water of the west and the warm, soft rains that glisten in the garden as the soil thaws. And the city gardener inserts a spade to turn the soil, and the farmer rouses from a winter respite to begin the tilling and planting. Welcome, spring. Welcome, gentle beauty. Celebrate this season of new life and new possibilities.
We come from the water, living in the water. Go back to the water, turn the world around. We come from the water, living in the water. Go back to the water, turn the world around. Whoa!
From earth of the north, with its rich brown soil that gives way to a soft green aura. the gentle stirring of growth beneath the dead leaves and grass of winter. And day by day, we watch new life emerge and unfold. Welcome, spring. Welcome, gentle beauty. Celebrate this season of new life and new possibilities.
Just give it a week when flowers are blooming down by the creek.
Bees will be buzzing as trees start to bud, but for the moment, I'm covered with mud.
Snow has been melting since winter is through, replacing the whiteness with puddles of goo.
I stepped off the sidewalk and into the ooze. Next thing I knew, I stepped out of my shoes.
Mud on my ankles and mud on my clothes.
I stumbled face first and got mud up my nose.
Spring will be pretty, but I must confess, the first days of spring are a muckety mess.
What is green? By Mary O'Neill.
Green is the green is the grass and the leaves of trees. Green is the smell of a country breeze.
Green is a coolness you get in the shade of the tall woods where the moss is made.
Green is a flutter that comes in spring when frost melts out of everything.
Green is a grasshopper. Green is a jade. Green is hiding in the shade.
Green is an olive and a pickle. The sound of green is a water trickle.
Green is the world after the rain, bathed and beautiful again and again.
Green is the meadow. Green is the fuzz that covers up where the winter was.
Green is ivy and honeysuckle vine.
Green is yours.
Green is mine.
Bird Talk by Eileen Fisher.
Think, said the robin.
Think, said the jay, sitting in the garden talking one day.
Think about the people, the way they grow. They don't have feathers at all, you know.
They don't eat beetles. They don't grow wings. They don't like sitting on wires and things.
Think, said the robin.
Think, said the jay. Aren't people funny to be that way?
The Robin by Anonymous. The wind told the grasses.
And the grasses told the trees.
The trees told the bushes.
And the bushes told the bees.
The bees told the robin.
And the robin sang out clear.
Wake up!
Wake up! Spring is here!
All right. Thanks so much for sharing poetry with us. First Unitarian Society is a Congregational Humanist congregation, and that means that we as a group take care of ourselves and our neighbors and our planet. On Sundays when we gather, we take a few moments to reflect on the joys and sorrows and milestones of the human experience, and we do this to stay in touch with our own humanity and to remind ourselves of the value of a moment of stillness and deep breathing. A reminder, a celebration of the life of FUS member Ginger Wilson will be held here on Saturday, April the 15th at 10:30 a.m. with a reception to follow. A reminder that after assembly today, if you're downstairs, we do have a card basket to send a note to folks who cannot attend our assemblies for whatever reason. Today, we take a few moments to reflect on violence and oppression and on those in our world who work to comfort the suffering and to work for justice.
breathe in peace, when I breathe out, I'll breathe out love.
Good morning. I'm Jenna Hutchinson, a member of the FUS stewardship team, and I'm here this morning to report on the progress of our pledge campaign for the 23-24 fiscal year. As of Friday, 109 of our 178 pledging units, which may reflect individuals, couples, or families, have returned a pledge form to FUS office. So much thanks to all of you who have done so. Pledges received total nearly $340,000. We know that there are additional members and friends who have automatic payments coming to FUS who didn't return the form. But for those of you who haven't returned the form, the stewardship team and the budget team would appreciate hearing from you. It's much easier for our budget planning for the coming year to have a firm idea of how much money we can expect from our congregants. We haven't yet met our goal of $375,000, a realistic goal that was set based on planned expenses for staffing, programming, building maintenance, and more. So if you didn't yet consider making an increase in your pledge for the coming year, and you have the ability to do so, all of us members and staff would appreciate your consideration. You can swing by the office today with your pledge and help us reach that goal of $375,000. And then we can all have another great year at FUS. So thank you for your consideration and your generosity. I'm also going to read an announcement from that my husband was scheduled to make, but he ended up not feeling well and went home early. We made something big happen here yesterday. And do you know what that was? Some of you were here for the Before Box birthday bash. FUS was venue number 3 out of a 5-site series of musical recitals featuring 4 pieces by J.S. Bach performed by local artists. A particular note here was a music student at the university by the name of Hui Chen, who sat down at the piano and swept us away with her performance of Partita number 4 in D major. So how did we do this? We picked up where previous members and friends of this congregation left off investing $3.5 million in renovations, including new ventilation systems, a new roof, new windows, new gender agnostic restrooms, and more. We invested our pledge contributions in our staff, including the resourceful Tim Rail, who along with his building stewards prepared this auditorium for over 100 guests attending the performance. Our contributions paid the heating bill, the electric bill, and the cost of snow removal. Sadly, we were unable to provide parking, but we do provide vouchers for the use of the Vineland ramp on Sunday, another gift that our contributions make possible. So thank you for making the Before Bach Birthday Bash music program possible. There are, of course, much more that we can do. Our February member contribution givings fell below our projections. And if you were out of town, like my husband and I were, you may have forgotten or you may have lost the checkbook in the space between the seat and the center console of your car. But we have a solution for that. You can visit the website and click on the Give link in the upper right-hand corner. You can use the Vanco mobile app or PayPal to make a donation. You can call Alan in the office to set up an automatic transfer directly from your checking account, or you can fish that checkbook out of the car and drop off a check in the office. Any way you choose helps and makes it matters. Thank you.
Robin in the rain, what a a saucy fellow, robbing in the rain. Mind your socks of yellow, running in the garden on your nimble feet. Digging for your dinner with your long, strong beak. Robbing in the rain, you don't mind the weather. Showers always make you gay. But the worms are wishing you would stay at home. Robbing on a rainy day. Robbing in the rain. Robbing in the rain. Socks of yellow, running in the garden on your nimble feet, digging for your dinner with your long, strong beak. Robbing in the rain, you don't mind the weather. Showers always make you gay. But the worms are wishing you would stay at home. Robbing on a rainy day. Robbing on a rainy day. Don't get your feet wet. Robbing on a rainy day.
Once, not so very long ago, there was a bluebird who liked to brag. After all, she was a very fine specimen.
But then again, aren't all bluebirds fine specimens? And who doesn't get a thrill out of seeing the return of bluebirds in spring?
But this particular bluebird had a very big ego. She would look at the sky, then she'd look at her wings and smile, a very satisfied sort of smile.
See how fine I look? I'm as blue as the sky.
The warm spring breezes greeted the bluebird as she flew high and low, northward into the clear blue sky.
Swooping into a green backyard, she spotted a mouse and landed nearby.
Oh, hello. Isn't it a beautiful day?
Yes, it is. The sky's such a lovely blue.
That's right. And I'm blue, too. Just like the sky. And just as beautiful.
Yes, you are. A beautiful spring-like blue.
But even as they said that, the mouse felt a tinge of sadness. No longer self-assured, the little mouse felt vulnerable and dejected.
I'm not the color of the sky. I'm not blue. Just a dull gray.
Too bad, so sad. Not every creature can be as lovely as me.
Smug and very satisfied with herself, the bluebird gave a little laugh and flew away.
Soon, she was flying over a zoo. The bluebird was surprised to see a flamingo in these parts and landed nearby.
Well, hello! Isn't it a beautiful spring day?
Yes. A fine and sunny day.
The bluebird was not accustomed to seeing flamingos up north, and this one was getting far too much attention from the onlookers at the zoo.
Don't bother yourself with those silly people. Look at me.
Now that she was back in the Northland, the bluebird wanted all the creatures to pay attention to her, to see what a fine specimen she was. She made spring special.
Look at the beautiful blue sky. See how blue and beautiful I am, just like the sky.
What of it? I'm pink.
Blue is better than pink. Blue is the color of the sky.
Well,
I'm not the color of the sky. I'm just an odd, out-of-place pink.
Now the flamingo was getting flustered and feeling vulnerable. They were not in their homeland.
But even though the bluebird made them feel very unwelcome and lonely, they tried to sound brave.
Some people like pink.
But the bluebird didn't care to listen. She quickly flew away without saying goodbye.
Landing again in a field not far away, the bluebird looked up and saw a blackbird at the top of a tree.
Surely she could impress this blackbird.
Hello, it's a beautiful day, isn't it?
Why, yes, it is.
See how blue I am? Just like the blue sky on this wonderful spring day.
Yes, I see. You are blue and I'm black. What of it?
Well, blue is better than black. Blue is beautiful. It's the color of the sky.
Now this blackbird was very wise.
Aren't all blackbirds wise?
Indeed, but this one was especially friendly and willing to share her wisdom.
Blue is beautiful, like you. And blue is the color of the sky, sometimes.
The blackbird was not finished. She had a lot more to say.
But the sky is not always blue. Sometimes it's gray, like a mouse. Sometimes it's pink, like a flamingo. And sometimes it's black, like me.
The bluebird was taken aback. Who was this brazen blackbird? What did she know?
When is the sky gray, like a mouse?
The sky is gray on a cool, cloudy day. On cloudy days, the sky is as gray and gorgeous as a mouse.
True. The sky is gray sometimes. You got me there. But gorgeous like a mouse, really?
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Well-read children seem to find mice quite adorable, and everyone knows cats go crazy over them.
Whatever, but when is the sky pink like a flamingo?
The sky is pink at sunset. In fact, at sunset, the sky is as pink and pretty as a flamingo.
Well, yes, sometimes I guess. But when is the sky black like you?
At night, of course. When the stars are shining bright, the sky is as black as I am.
The bluebird thought and thought. That blackbird sure did know something.
In fact, the blackbird was very wise. She had made her think about the gray mouse.
That's me, beautiful like the sky on a cloudy day.
And how the pink flamingo is the color of a sky at sunset.
Yes, I am. And just as lovely as the evening sky.
And that blackbird really is the color of the night sky.
Well, you are right. A mouse is gray as the sky, a flamingo is as pink as the sky, and a blackbird as black as the night sky.
And a bluebird, like you, as blue as the daylit spring sky.
Well, how about that? We are all colors of the sky.
And naturally, we are all beautiful.
And while the bluebird still liked being blue, she never bragged about it again.
Instead, she learned the wisdom of the blackbird, that earth and sky are filled with many colors, which together make a most beautiful world.
We're now going to sing De Colores. It's number 305 in your green hymnal, but the words will be up on the screen. And children, come to the front. Grab beautiful, colorful scarves so you can possess and have fun with this song.
flowers, all the colors. When the sunlight comes out through a rift in the cloud and it showers all the colors, as a rainbow appears when a storm cloud is touched by the sun. All the colors abound for the whole world around, for everyone under the sun. All the colors abound for the whole world around, and for everyone under the sun. All the colors, yes, the colors of people parading on by with their banners. All the colors, yes, the colors of pennants and streamers and plumes and bandanas. All the colors, yes, the colors of people now taking their place in the sun. All the colors abound for the whole world around and for everyone under the sun. Visto en los campos en la primavera. De colores son los pajaritos que vienen de afuera. De colores es algo arcoíris que vemos lucir. Y por esos los grandes amores de muchos colores me gustan a mí. Y por esos los grandes amores de muchos colores me gustan a mí.
All right, yay! All right, thanks everybody. Thank you everybody. Well, you know, being certain about something can cause some problems. For example, I am certain I know the way from my house to the grocery store. Okay, there are a couple of, maybe three different ways, but I know which one is the best way. I'm certain. But you know what? My wife goes a different way. How could anyone think there was a better way than mine to the grocery store? Who could even think that's okay? You know what I've got in terms of the best way to the grocery store is the certainty bug. Now, I did look it up on a map program, and when I did, I saw that my way is a little bit longer. It takes a little more time, but it's not about efficiency, is it? We need to enjoy the journey. Anybody can tell you that. My way to the grocery store is more restful and peaceful and beautiful. I've got a good case of the certainty bug. I insisted that my way is the shortest, the fastest, and when investigation shows that I might be wrong, well, the certainty bug does not die that easily, does it? The certainty bug was most certainly what got the scientist Galileo into trouble. You may remember at solstice, one of our seasonal celebrations team played Galileo back there in that dark winter time. He was the central character in our Mummers play. And there was Galileo making scientific observations that conclusively showed that the Earth did move. Now, chances are Galileo did not say "e pur se muove." I can't speak Italian because I just can't do the hands well enough. But and yet it moves is the English translation. And he's supposed to have said that after the Inquisition forced him to recant his heresy concerning the movement of the earth around the sun. So Galileo's And Yet It Moves is one of those things that we wish had happened, but it probably didn't, because no one expects the Spanish Inquisition. Although it was, in this case, the Roman Inquisition, but they wore red outfits as well. Now, Galileo was physically frail by the time he was tried for heresy, so chances are that he would not have risked imprisonment and torture even by mumbling something such as, "Nonetheless, it moves." But our theme this month has been vulnerability, and Galileo was vulnerable. He had published his heretical words. He was physically frail, so the Inquisition had him, if you will, dead to rights. What was such a big deal? Well, it was the certainty bug, wasn't it? The church was certain that our planet Earth was the center of the solar system, and therefore the center of the cosmos itself. The church was all-powerful in the Europe of the time, so their certainty bug mattered. It was dangerous to disagree with them. But as we know, all things are vulnerable, even the superpowers of the earth. And some of the church authorities knew enough about science that they knew that Galileo was probably right. Martin Luther King once quoted the British philosopher Thomas Carlyle saying, "No lie can live forever. No lie can live forever." Those of us who love to learn what objective reality has to teach us deeply love the probability of the human sciences that we will know a little more, and that no lie can live forever, because, as we know, yet it moves. So let's celebrate some more moving.
It wouldn't be spring if we didn't tell a story about a duck.
The one about the ugly little duckling?
No, no, no. It is about a little duckling, but not an ugly one.
Oh, good, because who would ever say such a thing? Ducklings are so cute.
Especially in spring, when everything comes back to life and adorable little critters are being born everywhere.
So let's tell the story of a happy little duck.
You got it. One spring, a cute and not so very old little duckling was learning all about themselves.
This little duckling liked being a duck. They liked their webbed feet.
And why not? They helped them swim fast as a fish.
The little duckling also liked having sleek feathers that helped them stay warm when they got wet.
And no doubt they liked having a duck bill. It was a colorful, awesome orange.
More importantly, a duck bill was great for catching bugs and other good things to eat.
But there was one thing the little duck did not like. They didn't like their quack.
What? A little duckling who didn't like their quack?
Nope. They didn't like their quack.
Why can't ducks sing like other birds? All we do is quack, 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 quack.
The little duckling went about asking all the other ducks this question, but all they would reply is, quack, 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 quack.
I don't want to just quack. I want to make music. Maybe I can learn to sing like the other birds.
So the duckling left their pond. They waddled down a path on cute little webbed feet.
They waddled under the trees and listened to the beautiful bird song that filled the air. Oh, how the little duckling wanted to sing like that.
They kept following the bird songs as they waddled along.
Then there it was, a bluebird in a bush, right in front of the little duckling.
Tweedledee, tweedledee.
Look, a bird as blue as the daylit sky.
And as beautiful as the sky could be in spring.
Hello, little birdie. I really like your song. It's so beautiful.
Isn't this the old bluebird who had been such a braggart? Remember her?
Of course, we just told that story a little while ago.
At what time that bluebird would have bragged, "Yes, indeed, don't I have a lovely voice?" But now she is all the wiser and instead replied,
"Well, thank you very much. Singing makes me happy.
And it makes me happy too. Will you teach me to sing like you?"
"Why do you want to sing like me? You're a duck. Ducks don't sing, they quack."
"I don't want to quack. I want to make music, a song like yours. Please teach me to sing."
The bluebird was stumped. She wanted to help the little duckling.
"Well, that's very kind of her now, but ducks can't sing like birds. How ridiculous."
"All right, let's give it a try."
"You've got to be kidding. That bluebird may no longer be a braggart, but she shouldn't give false hope."
Maybe not, but this bluebird was determined to help. She lifted her head, opened her beak wide as to demonstrate, and began to sing.
"Tweedledee-dee, tweedledee-dee, now you try."
The duckling lifted their head. They opened their duck bill wide and began to sing.
"Quack, quack, 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 quack."
"Well, I see I was wrong. Ducks can sing. I've never heard a duck sing as well as you."
Who is kidding whom here? Mocking that little duckling.
No, she's not. What she said was true. That bluebird has never heard a duck sing at all. So the duckling was singing better than any she had never heard.
"Really? I was singing? It sounded like quacking to me."
"Well, of course you were singing. Let's do it again, together this time. You have your part and I have mine."
Still feeling a bit unsure, the duckling gave it their best effort.
"Quack, quack, quack,
tweedledee-dee.
Quack, quack, quack,
tweedledee-dee.
Quack, quack, quack."
"Beautiful, you did it. We did it. Are you happy making music?"
"Yes, it was very nice, but I don't think I'm singing like you."
"Well, not exactly. But you are singing like a duck. And most important of all, you are happy doing it. Your quack is your song."
"Thank you, thank you. I can't wait to sing for my family."
"Oh, just remember, each of us makes our own kind of music."
What a brave little duckling. Despite feeling vulnerable, they tried something new.
And that bluebird supported them all the way.
Now the duckling waddled back to the pond as fast as their little webbed feet could carry them.
And from then on, the duckling loved everything about being a duck.
Just as the bluebird loved everything about being a bluebird.
She had grown very wise to see that difference can be beautiful.
Not divisive or distressing.
That's right. Variety is the spice of life.
Nature's harmony, the whole world round.
Quack, quack, quack.
Tweedledee-dee, tweedledee-dee.
So we're going to do a song by Bill Staines, and you're encouraged to sing along, particularly on the chorus.
Everybody rise, they can sing better.
We sing all the critters.
All critters. 1, 2, 3, 4.
All the critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Listen to the bass, it's the one on the bottom where the bullfrog croaks and the hippopotamus moans and groans with a big to-do. The old cow just goes moo.
The dogs and the cats, they take up the middle, with the honeybee hums and the crickets fiddle. The donkey brays and the pony neighs, the old coyote howls.
All the critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
Listen to the top where the little birds sing on the melody and the high notes ringing. The hoot owl hollers over everything. The jaybird disagrees.
Singing in the nighttime, singing in the day. The little duck quacks and he's on his way. The possum ain't got much to say. The porcupine talks to himself. All the critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing high. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
A simple song, a living song everywhere. By the ox and the fox and the grizzly bear. The grumpy alligator and the hawk above. The sly raccoon and the turtle dove.
All the critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got. All the critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands.
All right, thank you all. Please be seated. Well, you know, of all the critters, I think that we primates tell our story badly. All primates reason. All primates use tools, and all primates pass down learned knowledge to the next generation. By reason, what I mean is being able, as a sentient being, to stop a moment and consider your options rather than doing the same thing over and over. Consider a fly. It will continue to fly against a window pane. Some sentient beings, however, can pause and consider alternatives to flying repeatedly into the window pane. That's reason. It's really, I think, no more complicated than that, except we can use it in more and more complicated ways. For the fly, certainty is a feature, not a bug. It's always certain. It's going to act the same way every time. For some sentient beings, however, certainty can be a bug, not a feature. Again, we tell our story as primates badly. Yes, ancient structures such as Stonehenge were religious sites. Human beings have an emotional strategy, I would call it, that we call religious. Yet, many of those ancient religious structures were also precise mathematical instruments, measuring the movements of the earth and the stars. I, for one, am convinced that there have been more scientists, physicians, philosophers, and architects in all of human history than there have been priests. Consider the content of one ancient religion from one of the oldest continuous human civilizations, Egypt. The god Thoth is sometimes portrayed with the head of a baboon, sometimes that of an ibis, so sometimes a primate and sometimes a bird. One story about Thoth goes like this. In his time, the calendar had 360 days, and Thoth realized that this was not enough time for the earthly seasons to take place. So he asked the moon to give him 5 more days a year. Now, folks, this is not science, by the way, so this is mythology, so it's not going to work out. All right. No way am I working 5 more days in the year, said the moon in response. No way. That's fair, said Thoth. How about we make a bet? Forget about days. Let's gamble for fractions. Sure, said moon. How big a fraction? Oh, a little one, said Thoth. 1 1/72nd of your life, of your light, right? 1/72nd is all I want. Well, now, 1/72nd of the moon's light, if there's 365 days of the year, it's going to break down to 5 days or 7,200 minutes. That's all we want is a few minutes. Well, that's strangely precise, said the moon, but sure, I'll go for your bet. And though history nor mythology says what the game was, indeed Thoth won the game, got the 1/72nd of a earthly light year, and by golly, we now have 365 days in our calendar, all right? Now, if Thoth sounds a bit like the mythical character of a trickster, you're right about that. Prometheus is as well. The gods that bring humanity some kind of knowledge are often trickster gods. Thoth was supposed to also have invented writing, and he usually appears, if you look at the various kinds of pictures, with some kind of a writing instrument, which was a reed in ancient Egypt. Thoth is also thought to have created the math behind the pyramids, and he created the Ankh, A-N-K-H, the symbol for life and being itself, and as you can easily see, that's a precursor to the Christian cross. Thoth lives on in popular culture even to our day, a symbol of wisdom and creative adaptability, the ability to use our brains so that we don't have to act like the fly with certainty all the time. Now, besides a love for extravagant neckwear, the ancient Egyptian poets who invented the myth of the god Thoth and the Elizabethan era scientist Francis Bacon had also interests in creative adaptability and in experiment. They both learned the wisdom of checking with the earth before you make claims about reality. Sir Francis Bacon is commonly credited with formulating what we today call the scientific method, and he's famous for formulating the phrase scientia potentia est, knowledge is power. Now, it is interesting that it first looks like the word science, and that is where it comes from, though from the verb scientare, which is to chop apart, to cut up into little pieces so that you can look at things. And scientia in this case is knowledge, and potentia is potential, right? Not power, but potential, the potential of knowledge. Galileo improved on the existing telescopes of his time, and he turned that telescope to the moon, and he wrote what he saw. He said he saw a strange spottedness on the moon, a strange spottedness. No one had ever seen that strange spottedness on the moon before. It wasn't smooth like porcelain, rather, it was strangely spotted. Certainty died at that moment. And as I said before, no lie, even an unintentional lie, even a confused mythological fib, none of those can last forever. We were then, we are now, and we will always be primates looking at the stars. That's always been what we were, and it always will be. Our greatest enemy has always been our own egos and our certainty. Our greatest strength, now and forever, is our awe and our wonder.
And now we're going to sing Come Sing a Song with Me, number 346 in your hymnal, except we are going to sing The Darkest Times instead of Winter Time.
Please rise.
To find
this time.
Please be seated.
Earth of the North and bread of life, sprouting through black and brown and red rich soils, prepare again for us a table of plenty and a feast for our eyes. Make gardeners of us all, ecological stewards of the land, ever mindful of you this springtime.
Water of the West and fountain of life, cycling through melting snow, foggy mists, and pouring rains, wash away the dregs of winter as you swell streams and fill aquifers. Shower us with creativity and good sense to be water wise, ever mindful of you this springtime.
Fire of the South and source of life, shining light and energy into our delicately balanced biosphere. Brighten our days with splashes of color and shades of beauty. Warm us to the choices of wisely harnessed power and well-used resources. Ever mindful of you this springtime.
Air of the East and breath of life, circulating currents of change and fair weather winds, blow a warm breeze that gathers the sunshine and tickles our senses. Clear our heads of stale ideas and invigorate us for new endeavors. Ever mindful of you this springtime.
Thank you.
Go out into the world, be fearless, ask questions, hold on to what is good. Strengthen the weak, comfort the fearful, serve the suffering. Do what makes you come alive, because, as the great Harold Thurman said, the world needs more people who have come alive. So may it be.
You don't want to hold on to it? I'm not using it. Well, there are a lot of people who do.